This programming example is a very simple web browser and web server to illustrate the usage of TCP sockets. So let's start with the browser. It's here in web browser package. So this very simple browser will only connect to an HTTP server, ask for a specific resource, and then print whatever is returned. So there are two command line arguments. The first is the host to which the browser will connect, and the second is the port number of the server. So first open the socket, create the socket here, which means there is a connection request sent to this particular server and the port, and when the constructor of the socket class here returns, there is an established connection and the communicating socket is stored in this variable here. Then we set the timeout. We are not going to wait forever for answer from the server. It's in milliseconds and it's 10,000 milliseconds, so we will wait for 10 seconds for an answer from the server. Then we get this output stream of this socket. So the output stream method of the socket class will return an output stream that's connected to the socket. So whatever is written to this output stream will be sent over the network to the connected socket on the receiving side. And so the output stream is wrapped in a print writer, which is stored in the to server variable. And the purpose of the print writer stream is the print line method. So then we send data to the server. First we send the HTTP request, which is this. So we are always asking for root. The path to the requested resource is just slash. Okay, then we send the header. The HTTP 1.1 protocol will not work. Specifies that there will be no answer from the server unless the host header is specified. Then, according to the HTTP protocol, there must be an extra end of line after the header, which is sent there. And remember to flush. So this flushing business is very important. It might be that the data we send remains in some internal buffer in some of the streams or in the socket. But when we call flush on the stream, the streams and all internal buffers are emptied, and so the data is really sent to the receiving side. So if it seems that sending is okay but you never get any data at the receiving side, then you might have forgotten to call flush. Okay, so when we arrive here, data is sent, then it's time to wait for answer from the server. We retrieve the input stream of the socket, which is where data sent over the network to this socket will be delivered. It's wrapped in an input stream reader, which translates from the byte-based API to the character-based API of the readers. And then we wrap it in a buffered reader. And the buffered reader provides the readline method, which enables us to read everything up to end of line. So we stay in this loop and loop until there is nothing more to read. And the fact that there is nothing more to read is communicated by the readline method returning null. So for each turning in the loop, we just read from the socket and print what's read to standard out. So it will simply print the answer received from the server. Note that it ignores the length header, which is not a very good idea. We just assume that when there's no more data to read, we have received the entire answer from the server. That's not a reasonable assumption. We should have checked the length header returned by the server to see that we received the actual number of bytes that were sent. So then let's run it. It will connect to, let's have a look at the command line parameters. So it requests an answer from the www.kthse server on port 80. Okay, so we run. So the answer is in fact not that exciting. It turns out that we got a 301 response, which means the site has moved permanently to HTTPS and had it been a real browser, it would have understood this and made a new request using HTTPS. But okay, anyway, we got an answer from the server. Now let's have a look at the HTTP server. So this is a very simple web server. It takes two command line arguments. The first is the root directory of the file tree, where the server will look for requested files. And the default is www. The second argument is the port number the server is listening on, and the default is 8080. The server starts, server object is created, arguments are parsed, and then we go to the serve method, where the server will spend its life listening for connection requests and handling HTTP requests. The serve method starts by opening a listening socket, that is a server socket, JavaNet server socket, on the specified port number. The port number is 8080, unless anything else was specified on the command line. So this is a very typical sequence of a TCP server. First open a server socket, and then accept requests, connection requests on that socket, and that happens here, where the server calls accept, and accept will block until a connection is established. That is, a client has made a connection request and the connection is established on the TCP level. When that has happened, the accept method returns and we have a JavaNet socket stored in client socket here on which communication takes place. So this socket is the one that is connected to the socket on the sending side on the other end, the one that made the connection request. So then we configure this socket with a linger time before we start to use it. And remember that linger meant that when the client socket is closed, it does not close immediately, but still tries to send data that is unsent for the linger time period. Okay, so then we have an established connection on the client socket. Then we start a new thread to handle this socket, this connection. Remember that we cannot have the same thread accepting connections and handling connections, because consider this thing here. Say that we have just one thread, T, and it opens a server socket. There is a connection request from a client. So the connection is accepted by the server socket, and a communicating socket, JavaNet sock, is established. So then the remote node is now connected to this socket, and the thread T stays here communicating. But what now if another client makes a connection request to the server socket? Nothing happens. This connection request, the black one here, is not accepted because the server's only thread will be busy communicating with the first client. Okay, so this is absolutely not appropriate architecture. Instead, the server must be multi-threaded. So there then we have this thread T1, let's say, which opens the server socket. There is a connection request from a client. Connection is accepted and a new local socket is created. The client is now connected to that one, but then the thread T1 must turn around and again listen for connection requests, that is call accept on the server socket. And there must be a new thread, T2, which communicates on the established connection. And now if another client tries to connect, that is fine, because the thread T1 has again called accept and can accept this connection. So it will be connected to yet one more socket on the server side. And then the main thread T1 will again turn around and accept more connections. So that's why we need a multi-threaded server. Okay, so here the new thread is started, and the thread executes the request handler class, which implements runnable and therefore can be executed in its own thread. So the request handler needs the communicating socket that is connected to the remote node, and it needs to know the root directory where to look for files. Okay, then we increase the priority of the communicating thread. The idea is that we prioritize communicating with existing threads rather than accepting more connections. Then start the handler, the handling thread, handling this particular client. Let's have a look at that thread. Here's the run loop of the thread handling a particular connection with a particular client. So the first thing to do is to read and parse the HTTP request, and then this very simple server only supports HTTP GET. So if the request was an HTTP GET, then it's handled. Otherwise, we send an error message saying that the other method that was used is not implemented. Okay, so there are three main things to look at here: how to read a request and parse it, how to send a response, and how to handle errors. First, let's see how to read the HTTP request. It's done in the read request method here. So client soc is the socket that is connected to the remote node sending the HTTP request. And we get the input stream, which can hand out data received from the remote node. It's wrapped in an input stream reader, which translates the stream API, byte-based stream API, to the character-based reader API, and then wrapped again in the buffered reader, which provides the readline method. And the buffered reader also gives the ability to read more than one byte at a time, which is more efficient. Okay, but now we can read one line, and stored in request line. If it was null, there was no data to read, and then we just return null, do nothing. But if we got a request line, if there was a line that was read, then we split it into the three parts. So actually an HTTP request consists of three space separated parts. First the HTTP method, which hopefully is GET, and then the path to the resource that the HTTP client wants to retrieve. Maybe it's just slash as in the root, or slash index.html or whatever. And then the HTTP method, which could be, for example, HTTP 1.0. Okay, so those three parts are parsed with the split method, and they go in these three elements in the request tokens array. Following that first line of the HTTP request, there might be more lines, which then would be HTTP header lines, and those are handled here. So an object of the inner class HTTP request is created with the HTTP method, path to the resource, and the HTTP version. And then also headers are added to that, to the object of that class. So let's have a look at that class here. So not very interesting perhaps, just stores this data. Okay, now we are back at the run method of this client handler. So provided there was a request, then the request is not null, but we actually got the HTTP request and parsed all its versions. Then we see if it was an HTTP GET, then we handle the GET request. Let's look at handle GET request. Remember, all the parts of the request were stored in this HTTP request object passed there. So now it's time to send a response to the remote node. So then we get the output stream of the socket and wrap it in a print writer here. And the print writer provides the print line method that can be used to send the response. Okay. But before we send the response, we must retrieve the content of the file that was requested. So if the path to the resource that is requested ends with slash, it means it's a directory, but no directory listings with this HTTP server. So we instead read the index.html file of that directory. Okay, so the file is read, Let's have a look at reading the file. Remember that the path is relative to the root path, with which by default is www for this server. So we create a file object representing this relative path in the root directory, then open a file input stream from this file, and create a byte buffer that can contain the content of the file, if there is room for the all file content, and then read. And again, a bit cheating in this example. Coming examples are more well written. But here we don't check that we read the file content. We just assume that all content of the file was really read. Back in handle get request. So the file is read and is stored in this byte array. Then we check that we got an HTTP version. We don't care if it's 1.0 or 1.1 or some other strange version. But if there is, if the request was an HTTP request, we send a response. So send the OK status, HTTP OK response. So according to the HTTP specification, an OK response starts like this. Then we send the date header, good for caching. Then we send the server ID header. This is quite anonymous server. It has no name. It's just a HTTP server. I don't think it really follows the HTTP 1.0 specification in all particularities. Then we send the length header, which is very important. The browser will try to read. The browser cannot know how long the answer is, so it will try to read length bytes, the number of bytes specified by the content length header. So it will try to read. The browser will try to read content length number of bytes, and if the length header is absent, the browser cannot know when it is done reading. So it will look as if it's continuously loading, expecting more data. We also specify the content type header using a MIME type. So the MIME type here is based on file extension in this method here. Then the OK response and the headers are sent, and finally it's time to write the actual file content. And then we're done, provided the file was found. But if the file was not found, we send the not found response, which is the HTTP 404 not found response here. And there was also the not implemented response if the HTTP method was not get. We cannot handle any other HTTP methods in this simple server. There's also a content of the 404 error and the 501 error. So let's finally then have a look at the send error message method that is called here if the sending fails. Send error message took the string specifying the first line of the response and HTML if there is a body of this error, and version, which is just used here to check that this is really an HTTP request. Okay, if it was an HTTP request, we send the error status, the date header, the server ID header, just like with an OK response. The error body of an error message is always HTML, so the MIME type is text HTML. And then send the the HTML content of the particular error. And as usual, remember to flush. Always flush to be sure the message is actually sent. Then we are done. And as you can see in the run method, when either the appropriate answer or an error message has been sent, we just go to the finally block and close the socket, and then leave run method. So connections are not kept alive here. Once an answer is delivered, the connection is closed. So an important thing to note here is that when there is a finally block of a try catch finally statement, the finally block is always executed. There is no way to leave a try block without doing the finally block. It doesn't matter if you type return here in the middle or return or whatever, the finally block will be executed anyway. Let's run also the server. So the server is running. So the server is running on localhost, and the port is 8080. So the server is up. Actually, there is in the www directory, there is an index.html file saying server is up to, so we can try it. And this is the file that was delivered now. Clicking this button will generate a post request, and remember, post methods were not implemented by the server, so we get the not implemented method, the not implemented answer. Also, finally, let's try a non-existing file, and it will say, will give the 404 file not found message. Okay, that's the server.